Namaste, Adivakta Parishad Bangalore organizing this online seminar in collaboration with News 13. We will start this program with a prayer from Kumari Kavya.
Aravind Dadayataksham Aravind Dadayataksham Shishugopave Shugopikanya Sahasra Pariveshtitam
is a part of a larger family of patriots who have dedicated themselves for rebuilding of our nation. The organization makes the right intervention within justice delivery systems and contributes to the law making process for welfare of people and regenerate of institution vital for the nation. So Adivakta Parishad is a training the young advocates to be good lawyers with a social commitment so that justice delivery system we strengthen at all levels, the free from the pressures and corruption. Adivakta Parishad is a catalyst. It provides a cutting edge to Sajjan Shakti. That means it's a positive force. So today in the present scenario of COVID-19, when entire family staying at home gets to introspective themselves about their relationship and their family values, it has made their family bondage strong. And we from Adivakta, which is the largest nationalistic organization in India, have been conducting many virtual sessions throughout the country, wherein many luminaries from the field of law and other areas have given their views on various topics of law. Our organization motto, Nyaya Mama Dharma, it is very apt that today's speaker, Srimati Aarti, will be speaking about the glimpse into Bharatiya Raja Dharma, which has got its intrinsic value and which have followed our rules from time immemorial. In this session, our speaker will take back us to epic eras when there were no codified laws or constitutional, but with such rules, the people, including the rulers, used to follow the path of Dharma as a part of their life. So I would like to invite the speaker, that is Srimati Aarti, to throw more light on this topic. As I would like to first introduce about Dr. Aarti VB. She is a founder chairperson of Vibhu Academy, Bangalore. She is expertised in scholar in Sanskrit and Indian Indian studies, that is Bharatiya Vidyas, and behavioral and soft skills trainer. And even she is expertised in law, that is lay counsellor. So I would like to invite and welcome our speaker, Srimati Aarti, to throw more light on this wonderful topic.
Namasarvebhyah. Namaste to one and all. A very good morning to all of you. Shubhodaya Suprabhatam. We are here to discuss about Raja Dharma, the concept of polity, the concept of statesmanship, the concept of ruling and law, and many more things. The word Raja Dharma is quite a very vast one. It has many meanings to it. So what is a Rajyam? According to Manava Dharma Smriti, it is Swami Amatya Pura Rashtra Kosha Danda and Suhrut. It means the Swami, the head of the whole system, the king, the ruler. And then the Amatya, his ministers, his appointed or elected officials. And then Puram, the whole area, the region. Rashtram, the concept of collective entity of many smaller entities. Many provinces come together and they form a huge nation or a Rashtra. Then the Kosha, the treasury, the resources that the particular kingdom has. And then Danda. Danda is law. It is a law, it is a punishment, it is the kind of the system that sustains Dharma, that sustains justice in the society. And then Suhrit, friendship. Friendship, or what we call external affairs today. So these are the major saptangas of Rajya according to Manava Dharma Smriti. So these are the most important thing. They always used to be a constitution. They were courts. It's not that we never had a constitution. We never had a court. Everything was just happening just like that. It was not so. We had a very well organized structure. It was, in fact, we had a much more dynamic and sustainable kind of structure. Because when you study the Rajadharma in its various dimensions, we see that one of its main important nature is sustainability. So this Rajadharma is very, very old. We all know it's ages old, not just centuries, but millennia old. From thousands of years, it has ruled, it has been respected and practiced. No system or no theory or concept which does not do justice will last for so long. people will slowly start rejecting it. There will be unrest, there will be dissent, and slowly there will be some revolution somewhere, and it will vanish. So that is what we see. So many rules and many ideas, many ideologies, many systems come and go, because that is how it happens. But we see the concept of Rajadharma, the very basic ideas of Rajadharma have lived through all these ages. In fact, India has gone through the worst dark periods when we had terrible onslaughts, the Arabic and the Middle and the European onslaughts, which were very barbaric, very Asuric in nature. Because when I say Asuric, I mean they were demonic. The people from the Middle East or from Europe who invaded India never had any rules in the war, no ethics at all. They used to just plunder and loot and kill, and it was very demonic, against every rule. They broke every rule. It was just a proxy war. So we have lost so much of land, so much of our culture, so much of our beautiful temples and treasures and systems and kingdoms and clans, of course. But with all these losses, still somewhere the Rajadharma has been quite very vibrant. There are so many areas, regions all over India where the Rajadharma has been practiced till very, very recently. In fact, when I talk about my own state, Karnataka, we have this Mysore Vodayar clan who, till they united into the bigger India, they have practiced the beautiful values of Rajadharma, and the Mysore Maharajas are greatly regarded by the people here. We can see their buildings, their roads, and all the beautiful contributions they have given, the systems they used to follow. So this has been a sustainable system. Despite many onslaughts, we have been able to redesign and restructure ourselves. That shows that the concept of Rajadharma is quite very strong and substantial. Secondly, it is very dynamic. What we see in all the ages is, throughout the Smriti era or the medieval times, there have been a lot of modifications done. It is not like that there's one book and one person has written something and nobody dare change that law, no, and put a full stop. It's not like that. It has always been open to modification. We can compare that to a huge tree. The tree is growing and growing and growing. Newer and newer branches are coming, and some old leaves are, some smaller twigs are falling down, and newer leaves are blossoming, newer flowers are blossoming. So old things go, new things come. But this whole system called tree is sustained by something which doesn't ever move, and that is the root. So we have the root part of our Rajadharma, which is Dharma itself. And then we have the shoots part of it, which is always dynamic and growing. So this is the structure of not just Rajadharma. This is the structure of the Indian born religions, Indian born culture, Indian born literature systems, Indian born anything. It could be art. So we retain the core of that particular Shastra. And then we also open up to newer and newer avenues, newer and newer modifications. So in this spirit, even our Rajadharma has time and again accumulated many beautiful ideas from outside. Anobhutraha kratavoyantu vishvataha. May good noble thoughts come to us from every corner of the world is the attitude we have always had. So it's been very dynamic. It's been accommodative. So after all the onslaughts and invasions, we have learned to digest them and continue to look ahead and not keep looking back and brooding. So this beautiful Rajadharma, which is dynamic, accommodative, and still it retains its uniqueness, is the another beautiful aspect of Rajadharma. Then it's dharma-centric. So this is very important. We need to understand the word dharma properly. Unfortunately, it's been translated into religion, faith, cult, etc. It's just not that. And dharana dharma ityahu. Dharayati iti dharmaha. The very definition of dharma means a system that sustains. There are two aspects in dharma. One is the yashti, another is the samashti. We all live with these two things together in life. Anybody, any society. One is the individual welfare. Like, it's my desire to do so. It is my attitude. I like this. This is my opinion. So we have a framework called me. That is called yashti. Then we have a samashti. We have the community in mind. So there will always be a beautiful harmony between these two. And if the vyashti, if my interest, this is what I want, if this becomes very assertive, then there will be a very bad influence of the vyashti or the samashti. So everybody try to go very individualistic, and then there's a break and the unity goes and all the problems in the society starts. So dharma tells you that you always live with your vyashti, no problem. Go ahead, pursue your personal desires, your ambitions, do what you want, fine. But remember, you live in a bigger samashti. And there will be moments in our life, there will be some periods, there will be some instances when we, when a question comes where, will you compromise your vyashti for samashti, or will you compromise the samashti for your vyashti? So it happens in everybody's life. For example, now we are all facing that, the corona lockdown period. So now we all have on our weekends, we used to just hang around, go to movies, go to hotels and just have a lot of fun, go visit our relatives or just do some cleaning at home. But we have less choice now because in the interest of the national health, in interest of everybody's health and our own health also, in the interest of samashti, we have to compromise our vyashti. We just better stay home. So there are such instances in life when we will have to compromise our vyashti. So dharma tells you that, okay, go ahead with your vyashti, go ahead with your personal desires and ambitions. But always remember that there will be instances when you have to think of a bigger good, the community good. So this is the basic idea we see in Rajadharma also. Because if a common man offends his neighbor or offends the society, there will not be a very big damage. But if a king or a leader or a minister or an MP or an MLA does the same mistake, it will be a very, very bad thing. So a common man can do some loose talk and just be forgiven or forgotten. But when a minister or somebody very visible gives a loose statement, just says something, does something, is careless, then immediately it becomes a very big news. It becomes a breaking news the next day. It's very natural because a person in the role of a king has to be extra careful about implementing these rules. So he should completely keep his vyashti, his personal interests, suppressed by the national interest. If he's so interested about his personal interest, he better quit the role of the king. So this is the basic idea that rules our Rajadharma. So samashti above everything. So with these, with this beginning, I'd like to go into the Rajadharma aspects. In fact, I should first confess that in such a short time, and we can't really complete everything there. There is so much. In fact, I'm not exaggerating, but there are so many points. In fact, we can have MBA courses on Rajadharma. Unfortunately, in the Indian MBA courses, we don't have a line of Chanakya. We don't have a line of the beautiful concepts of management or leadership or statesmanship, which has been told in such a beautiful country, an age-old country with time-tested lots of trials and errors done and so much understood and so many beautiful concepts recorded. So we will just have a glimpse. That is why we call this a glimpse into Rajadharma. It's just a glimpse to see. I'm just trying to open a window to say, look, there's so much more. The sky is so vast. So we have a lot of records of all this. Fortunately, we have the Smritis, and even in the Vedic lore, we have a lot of inputs of Rajadharma. In fact, the concept of Varna Dharma, which has been very badly misdefined, misinterpreted, misunderstood, thanks to the leftist thinkers and the Britishers, the Macaulay system, which asserted upon dividing India on the basis of caste, they called our Varna as caste. Caste was not something else and Varna was something else. Varna was based on Guna and Karma. Here the Varna called Kshatra, the Kshatriya Varna, is basically nothing but a community or an individual completely committed to sustain the Rajadharma, to be committed to Rajadharma. So it's been very well recorded. The Varna Padhati, the Kshatra Dharma Padhati, is nothing but a record of Rajadharma. And then we have the Smritis, which were the constitutions of those days. Just we have the Samvidhan today, they were called the Smritis or the Dharma Shastras in those days. And we've had repeated modifications of the Smritis. There was not one Smriti for all the time. So that is the beautiful aspect of Indian society, where we are ready to weed out everything and retain what is good. So like, we don't burn down the crop, we retain what is good and we weed out what is bad. So this has happened time and again. So we see a lot of modifications and changes, very, very notable changes in the Smritis also. Then we have the Ramayana and Mahabharata, which are not just stories. In fact, the Ramayana and Mahabharata are basically teaching us Rajadharma through the stories of Rama and Krishna. It could be Rama or Krishna or the Pandavas, the Kauravas. They were all basically princes. So the whole of the epics are trying to derive the lesson to us through some positive and negative examples as to how a leader should be and how a leader should not be. I would like to quote the very famous sloka from Bhagavad Gita. Yadyad acharati shreshtah tatta devetaro nanaha sayat pramanam kurute lokas tadanu vartate. So whatever a shreshtha means a leader or a nayaka or a king or an elder, whoever is in a position where he or she has a following. So what he does, everybody follows. Sayat pramanam kurute lokas tadanu vartate. The masses usually just follow the trend. So start a good trend. That is what it means. Because what the Raja does is very important. If the king, if the ruler, if the leader is not confident, then the whole team goes diffident. If the leader is corrupt, corruption seeps down the line. So if the leader is strong and motivated, the motivation radiates to everybody else. So if the leader is positive, positivity radiates around. If he is negative, if he is pessimistic, if he is cynical, sadist, everything radiates around. So Rajadharma is about how a kshatriya or how a king or a ruler or somebody who is in that process is extremely committed and careful and very, very judicious in everything he says, thinks or acts. And Kshatra, which is another name for Rajadharma, you can say, a very, very important aspect of Rajadharma. Kshetra Rakshanat Kshatriya, to protect, Kshetrasya Rakshanam, to protect a Kshetra, an entity, a kingdom or a Rashtra is called Kshatriya. So Kshatra itself means that to protect. There are two aspects in protection. One is to sustain and one is to actually protect. So when we say protection, we have the sainya part, we have the defense which protects our boundaries and keeps us safe from external threats. And then we have the internal system, one is the police system where they are completely, they keep control of, they keep track of everybody's behavior and see that the good people are not troubled by the bad people, etc. Then we have the law, which helps people get justice in a methodical manner. So these are the important forms of protection that are monitored by the Rajadharma. So law is very much a part of Rajadharma. Police and the army is very much a part of Rajadharma. They were completely handled and monitored by the rulers. And then the second part is sustainability, to sustain the whole system. Here comes the administrative aspect where the ruler rules, and developments are done and buildings are constructed, civil engineering and maintenance department, administration department, using resources, human resources, recruitment, job generations and many things like that. Because we had a very self-sustainable employment system, a self-employment system in India, employment was not such a huge problem as we see today. Because today we all unfortunately believe that degree is the only means that can get me a job. So we are all after a degree and after a job, a salaried job, and we don't wait to think what I can do otherwise. So we are all conditioned in this system where you think that first have a degree, get a job, then think of anything else. But that was not so then. So we had a very different system of education. That's a very beautiful branch of study which needs to be explored, in fact. So we used to have a system where skill training was given to every person in the society. There's a very wrong myth that a few Brahmanas only knew everything. They never imparted knowledge to everybody. That's a pukka nonsense. So everybody had skill training. Maybe some Vedas and some Vaidika karmas the Brahmins did. But otherwise everybody was trained basically in their own homes or clans at specialized gurukulas where they were given training. So education was taken care of by the Raja Dharma, by the Raja Vyavastha, and administration was taken care of, and the Raja, the very important part of Rajyanga was intelligence. So intelligence, they had internal and external again. They had Gudacharis, they had spies all over the country, outside their borders also, to just keep vigilance, to keep track of what probable threats we can have. And internally also, they used to have a lot of Gudacharyas. If you are interested, please read Chanakya's Arthashastra. There's an exclusive chapter called Gudachara Pranidhi. So it's very interesting how men and women, not just men, many varieties of women were employed in Godacharya. So we had women who used to be queens, who rode horses, who fought battles, who were entrepreneurs, who were poetesses, who were yoginis, who were scientists, who were surgeons, etc. So we had women quite very active. So we see how women were very active in all these areas. And also we had the Nyayanga. The courts were run, were monitored by the Raja. In fact, we used to have these prime ministers and chief ministers of the kings. And the chief queen was usually, they used to be very, very choosy about choosing the chief queen. A king could have many number of wives. Polygamy was quite common. But the chief queen was very important because she was usually a very educated woman. Somebody who was learned and who was well trained in statesmanship and Rajadharma. So we used to have these queens and they used to in fact handle the whole of administration and everything the king does in his absence. If he went on expeditions or if he went on war or any other official duty, the queen would completely take over his roles. So such examples are quite many. In fact, I am so proud that in our own Karnataka, we used to have these Chalukyan queens, where many of the Chalukyan queens have been great rulers, great administrators, great warriors also. And also, like we have the Abbakka, Rani Abbakka, Kiladi Channamma, Velavadi Mallamma, and Kittur Rani Channamma, and Shantala Rani, and Atti Mabbe. So each of them have excelled in their fields. So we used to have both kings and queens, the whole royal clan involved in Rajadharma. They all used to be trained. It is not just that the king sits on the throne and does everything. He used to have so many people assisting him. The whole of the royal family was involved in some or the other role of ruling and administration or intelligence, etc. And the basic criteria for Kshatra is very interesting. Very importantly, the pravritti, they say. It's not just by being born in a clan you become a kshatriya. According to Krishna, chaturvarnya maya srishtam guna karma vibhagashah. It's guna and karma. When he says guna, he is referring to one's pravritti, one's aptitude. If you have the aptitude and the attitude to rule, to serve, to lead people, you know, that's an attitude which comes with you sometimes. And it's usually born, they say leaders are born, not always, but to some extent. So it is the pravritti which you have to respect. Shri Krishna also calls it swadharma, one's own nature. It is my dharma, it's my nature. So I am born with it. So if a lotus is born as a lotus, it should always strive to become a better lotus. If the lotus thinks, oh, I'm a lotus, I'm in the mud, I'm in the rut, so let me become a jasmine, and comes onto the dry land, it dries off. Similarly, if a jasmine thinks, I'm so small, I'm so white, I want to become like the beautiful red lotus, and falls into the waters, it just decomposes. So becoming somebody is very stupid. What we are trying to do today, like Albert Einstein rightly said, if you judge a fish by its capacity to fly, you are very wrong. So that's what we are doing today. We are forcing all our children to study just something and prove themselves in that only that area. But here, Kshatra comes with pravritti. It could be anything. Brahma comes with pravritti. A born Kshatriya Buddha went for Brahma, he went for spiritual quest. He took the Brahma pravritti. His pravritti was Brahma. Similarly, a born in a Brahma vritti, born to a great sage called Pulastya, Ravana took to Kshatra vritti. So that kind of a switching over was always there because the idea is to respect one's pravritti. So if you have the pravritti, then you are a Kshatriya. That's the first criteria. Second is you have to have Shaurya. Shaurya means physical valor. It's not enough to just be a good ruler and all that. You should be physically also equipped. In these days, in the democratic system, we don't see our rulers being very powerful, very well built and being warriors, etc. That's gone. The era is gone, unfortunately. But if we look back into the Indian Rajadharma, one of the important criteria for a Kshatriya was to also be a warrior. He or she had to know warfare, had to know how to ride horses, had to know how to wield swords and different weapons, had to know every inch of how a battle is won. So it was not an exclusive thing which they just monitored or led by word. It was something which they had to lead by practice. So Shaurya was another important criteria for being a Kshatriya to follow the Raja Dharma. And the Shaurya was also a big valor of a Kshatriya, was also a big hope for everybody else. It was kind of promised to everybody, saying, I'm here to protect you. So the relentless practice of warfare and always exercise, and these were a part of to sweat in peace, was very, very important for a Kshatriya. The third was Vritti Dharma. Once a person takes up the Raja Dharma, he becomes a king or a ruler or a mantri or an officer, whatever rank, he takes up the Raja Dharma, he immediately has to commit himself to that. It is just do or die. Once you take it up, it becomes your kartavya. Kartavya means kartavyam, to do, must do. That is what the word means. Once it is your kartavya, you cannot back out. You cannot say, oh, I'm bored. It's monotonous. Oh, you cannot procrastinate. Or you can't say, I'll postpone it. Or I'll give up. No, we can't. There's no middle way here. There's no gray. It's either white or black. You either deserve to be a Kshatriya or you don't deserve to be a Kshatriya. So you must commit yourself to Raja Dharma. Once you have entered the throne, just remember that you are here just to perform. And the commit, you have to perform to an extent that you completely compromise everything called yours. So it's very difficult to be a king, actually. Like in the European models, we see a king means a very lucky fellow. He is just here enjoying on a coach, and he has so many people to keep massaging him and praising him, and he has a lot of money. He is a rich, spoiled brat. But back here in our Raja Dharma, the concept of Raja is very, very different. The Raja is a Praja Sevak, actually. That is what our Prime Minister also is using today. It's quite an age-old concept. Praja Sevaka. His life is only for the good of Prajas. So everything he does is for the Prajas, and he is given a lot of training. So the one more very important aspect which makes him a good king is training. There are two aspects of training. One is schooling, to get into the right kind of teacher's guidance, and it's called Vriddha Sanyoga. He goes to the Gurukula, he learns all the very important basic fundamental vidyas, and then specifically the Raja Vidya. And he learns a lot from his different seniors, his predecessors, and then his father and uncles and ministers, etc. Then he also has a lot of peer learning. And then after his formal education is done, after he is called a Snataka, somebody who has graduated from the training in Gurukula, then the education is not complete. He is sent for Deshatana. He is given a horse or nothing and no money, and just sent to go on a big travel and go and find see what the world is like. He has to be with people, he has to live with the poor people, and there will be many days when he does not get good food, he will have to sleep under a tree, stay in a dharmachatra, etc. But he will understand what life is. He will see the common man from a very close distance. He will see how people behave. He will understand the behavioral traits of people. To become a king is not just sitting on a throne and just dictating something. You can't expect the society to become utopian overnight by your dictate. It's not that. It's always a society which has its own challenges. People are people. Masses are masses. They have their own instincts. They have their own weaknesses. And so here the Raja has to first understand how the human weaknesses have a very, very important influence on the behavior and also the happenings in the society. So he has to be out. He has to go out and see people, be with people. And he has to have his dose of sukha and dukkha and understand what life is. That is called Vyavahara Jnana. So he gets a lot of loka jnana through that, and then he becomes a better king. And even after becoming a king, being coronated as a Yuvaraja or a Raja, even then he has to repeatedly go in disguise and try to find out what is happening across in the kingdom. So these are some very beautiful aspects which are asserted in Raja Dharma. I am trying to take points from all sources. We have stories, we have accounts, and we have our Arthashastra, etc. And so, it's not that just because there was a king, a ruler, he was a dictator and everybody had to just listen to him. Of course, we had some dictator like kings here and there. We had Ravana types also. But usually, a king was not so free. In fact, Ramayana says very clearly, Nayascha, Vinayascha, Ubhau, Nigraha, Anugrahau api. राजवृत्ति रसंकीर्णा न नृपाः कामवृत्तयः. सो नय विनय निग्रह अनुग्रह. सो ऑल दीज फोर द राजा हैज ऑलवेज टू कंसिडर. He can never have a kama vritti. Kama vritti means I'll do as I wish. I do as you please. That will not work. A raja has always has to keep all these four in mind, and he has to use his own learning, and he also has to specially refer again. Like if lawyers have a case, they know many acts very well, but still before they finally write down their reviews or reports or their whatever they have come to thought to be right, they will again refer to and take all the details and citations and write down. So that is Vinaya. And Nigraha Anugraha. Nigraha is to control and Anugraha is to support or to especially do a favor. So he has to keep all these in mind and he has to have the counsel of his ministers. In fact, in Ramayana, there is a whole chapter, the 100th chapter in the Ayodhya Kanda is called the Kachit Sarga, because most of the shlokas begin with the word Kachit, or you have the Kachit word in between also. And the whole beautiful, the discussion about Raja Dharma is extremely beautiful and very very useful today. Unfortunately, many people never see that also. But in Ramayana, that part is actually a conversation between Rama and Bharata. So Bharata comes to the forest to take back Rama, saying, you are the right heir to the throne. My mother did a very nasty thing. I don't agree. So you have to come back. It is dharma. It is my father's wish. It is the wish of the subjects. It's the wish of the people. It's my wish. It's everybody's wish that you come back and become the king. So please come back. And that is when the Ram and Bharat Milat happens. And that is when Rama discusses with Bharata and says, oh Bharata, I hope everything is fine in Ayodhya. And then the following conversation is a beautiful dialogue about Raja Dharma, or beautiful monologue on Raja Dharma. Rama goes on telling many beautiful things about Raja Dharma. He says, Rama should always, king should always, kachinna mantrese na ekaha, kachinna bahubhissa. I hope you don't always rely on just one person's advice all the time. Like what Dhritarashtra did, he only listened to Shakuni, and Duryodhana only listened to Shakuni. So you listen to just one person, and we don't know, that's only one angle, whether or not he's right. But that is only one angle. So to decide something based on just one person's counsel is not safe. And he also says, Kachinna Bahubhissaha, or you are listening to too many people, like too many cooks spoil the broth. You listen to too many people, you get confused and like it's too much. So I hope you are listening to the right people. I hope you recruit the right kind of people in your mantri mandala. You take the people who are your equals, who are as learned as you, as valorous as you, as experienced as you, and who are of a very good background, etc., and who are also valorous, and they are ingitajnyaha. Kachid atma samashuraha shrutavanto jitendriyaha. They are jitendriyaha. They have control over their senses. They are not. They don't do unethical things. They are not selfish. They are not cheap. And ingitajnyaha. They know what to do. You know, they can understand if you are in a group working together as a team for the society. You should understand each other so well. Even without saying, you should understand, yes, this is what would be his idea. So there are so many such shlokas. In fact, quite many shlokas. I'm just quoting here and there. And he says, mantro vijaya moolamati. So mantrana means to discuss. So you should always discuss. One is the Raja should always, like the Upanishads say, Svadhyaya Pravashanabhyam Mapramadaha. Just because you've completed your Gurukula tenure doesn't mean you throw your bag and books like this. I'm free, I'll never again have to read anything, prove anything. That's not so. You study all your life. So you keep on referring, keep on studying and discussing. And you discuss with people who have interdisciplinary language, interdisciplinary knowledge, and we brainstorm ideas and relentlessly discussing things will improve your insights, and maybe we are thinking in an ekadeshiya way, in one, only one angle. We have a frog in the well attitude, so that should go. You should get familiar with many kinds of opinions. So he says, mantrohi vijayamulam hi rajnyam bhavati raghava susamrato mantri durahi amatyai shastra kovidaihi. You should always be surrounded by mantris, ministers who are shastra kovidas, who know very well, they have experience, they have learning, and they have insights. You must have amatyas, you have officers, bureaucrats who are also very learned, very experienced and insightful. And apart from these, there will be specialized people who are just studying the different branches of study, and they are very specialized, and you also have to consult them. And Rama also tells about how a Raja should have a very, very disciplined routine every day. Kachin nidra vasham naiva. You don't go to sleep at the wrong time, or you just doze off when the mantra discussion is happening, or you are always, you sleep too much, or you sleep at the wrong time, or you don't get up at the right time. Kale avabuddhya secha. So you get up at the right time. You have to be very, very careful about your routine. And kachicha apararatreshu chintayasi artha naipunam. So apararatri is the last part of the night. That is very early in the morning, somewhere between 3 o'clock to 6 o'clock, just before sunrise. That is the most prashasta Brahmi muhurta, when the Raja is advised to have very important confidential discussions. In fact, you can see some, if you come to our Vijayanagara Hampi sites, you see those underground basement rooms where the kings used to have this mantrana. Chanakya says in Arthashastra that the room where the mantrana, the discussion is done, should be very, very confidential, and not even birds like Maina or parrot, which can repeat your words, also should not be allowed to come anywhere there. And just the Raja, the Mantri, and the Sainya Adhyaksha, the head of the defense, and then the Kula Adhyaksha, the elected or the nominated representative of all the people. So here we see that there was a democracy within monarchy. Although the Raja was the ruler, he was not a Raja who would just dictate. He could not dictate like that. He had to consider the opinions of people. So at the smaller levels, the villages and the communities, the different Varnas, the different people of different communities who practice different occupations. Varna basically refers to occupations, farmers' occupation, blacksmiths' occupation, and dancers and musicians and goldsmiths and so on. So each of them, within the community, they had a small democratic system. They used to elect a very important, a very senior person who used to be their democratic head and tell them the do's and don'ts. They used to have a small panchayat system within them. They used to have a kula purohita who would tell them the dharmic aspects, religious aspects. And for all these smaller communities, together they had an elected panchayat system. And that was again elected, re-elected, sometimes nomination, mostly elected. And all these people again, the elected heads used to have elections, and they used to elect a Kuladhyaksha or Kulamukhya, whatever different names we say. And he or she would be directly reporting to the Mantri, the main minister. So Raja had to consider the people's opinion through all these sources. And he also used to have the Gudacharis, the spies coming and telling about the subtle problems and subtle threats. However subtle, Agnishesham, Runashesham, never neglect that, they say. Just because something is a spark, you cannot neglect that. A spark may grow into big fire any moment. So Shatru Shesham, even a small threat should not be ignored or neglected. So a lot of such discussions the Raja should do. And all these are repeatedly told in our Dharma Shastras and the Smritis, etc. And the Raja is called the father of everybody. That is the attitude a Raja should have. He is like a father. Manava Smriti says, Prajanam Vinayadhanat Rakshanat Bharanadati. Prajanam Vinayadhanat. One who corrects, one who regulates the actions, that regulates the lifestyle of his prajas, of his subjects. Rakshanat, he also protects them. And Bharanat, he nourishes them. Because he does all these three, Sapita. pitarastasam kevalam janma hetavah. If they have their biological fathers, they are just janma hetavah, they have just given them birth. But the real father of everybody is the Raja, because he regulates the behavior of the people, he nourishes their lives, and he also protects them inside, within the kingdom and from external threats. So these are some beautiful aspects of Raja Dharma which are repeated. And Chanakya warns that kashchit kasyachin mitram na kashchit kasyachit ripuhu. For a Raja, for a leader, nobody is an absolute friend and nobody is an absolute enemy. Arthatastu nibadhyante mitrani ripavastata. This is a very general thing which Chanakya says. Anybody in this world, we have a working relationship actually. Because unless we have something called mamakara, some personal gain or some personal obligation, we never actually connect to anybody very, very honestly. That's quite a human thing he's talking about. So king should be very careful about this. He should not believe that somebody comes and praises him. So, oh, he is my best friend. I will always listen to him and always favor him. That kind of a favoritism should never happen. We have the example of the great Immadi Pulakeshi, the Pulakeshi II of the Chalukyan Empire, was a very mighty king. He in fact defeated the very, very valorous and mighty Harshavardhana of Maurya Samrajya, a very, very great thing, impossible thing he did. So he was such a valorous person, a very good administrator, very good ruler, lover of his subjects, and the Chalukyan Empire really prospered under him. Everything was fine. But there was one small weakness in Immadi Pulakeshi. He had a lot of passion, love for his younger brother, who was a spoiled child, a spoiled brat. So he was basking in the glory of his kingly brother. And he did all kinds of things, bad things. And this earned a bad reputation to Immadi Pulakeshi. Although he did not have the dispassionate approach to say, yes, if he is my brother, so what? I'm not going to punish him. He kept on forgiving him. We all know the very famous story of Mahabharata, where Dhritarashtra had a passion, blind passion for his son. So he just digested anything which Duryodhana did. So if a king has that kind of a blind passion or friendship for somebody, unconditional friendship, it's very dangerous for the kingdom. And if a king has a personal vengeance against somebody, we see today, we call this democracy, but whenever a party comes to power, the moment they come to power, they show that vengeance in the worst way. So they immediately start troubling the enemy parties, and they use their power for doing every kind of bad things. So that Raja should never be like that. He should never be an absolute friend or enemy to anybody. He should always be judicious and vigilant about who is really honest and who can work with him. And then regarding the training given to the king, Chanakya says that the first thing a king or a ruler or officer or anybody, any child who is going to take up an official job has to be taught is Indriya Jaya. It is not maths or science or polity or law or anything that should be taught first. It is Indriya Jaya. How to control your senses. How you can master yourself. Because our senses are just dragging our mind to different things. We just get lost in our vanities and desire for pleasures. So that should not happen. First learn to control your senses. It's not that everything you see you must get. Grab everything that comes your way. So this kind of consumerism attitude which we see today, go buy one get one free attitude, a discount attitude, just go and hoard things, hoard money and store things. And when we just look back and see our houses, we say, oh my god, so many things are there, unnecessary things. Someday we clean them up and start giving them away. So this kind of a hoarding attitude will come if we don't train our senses properly. So everything that we see or hear or everything that we come across through our senses need not be a bhoga vastu, need not be a pleasure thing for us. Learn to appreciate everything, but don't become greedy about everything. This is the first training a child has to be given. And the Gurukula Paddhati of India, the beautiful Gurukula Paddhati, which sustained the Indian society for ages and ages, which is unfortunately not being the mainstream education today after the Macaulay, very, very unscientific and commercial kind of education system came in, has trivialized the system. the Gurukula system used to be that the values are first taught, first control your senses. Today we see our children wasting a lot of time in front of the mirror or engaging at a girl next window, next door. But in our traditional system, the Raja or anybody was given training to control his senses, Brahmacharya path. Have absolute control your mind, over your mind, be a celibate and don't even look into the mirror, you'll be surprised. Throughout the Gurukula tenure, a student is not allowed to even glimpse into the mirror. So after the snataka, after the whole tenure is over, there is a small beautiful ceremony done, it's called Samavartana. So that then the child, the student who has completed, graduate, is shown a mirror and allowed to wear cosmetics and nice dresses and go around and enjoy life and be like anybody else. So those years of study in the Gurukula are for strictly only study. So Raja grows up that way. So he has perfect control over his senses. That is very important for the society. And when he recruits people, he has to always use a lot of judgment. Chanakya talks about three types of upadha. Upadha is test. Dharmopada, Arthopada and Kamopada. To recruit a person, you have to use three types of tests. First test, if he is Dharmopada. Is he righteous? Is he truthful? Is he honest? And does he, you give him a small job and just watch for some type of probationary period and see what type of a person he is. If he has a leadership quality where he very, very honestly does the job to the end, then yes, he is good for a very good role, a very responsible role. If he is working only if there is a CCTV camera behind, hey, somebody is watchful about him, policing him, he is working because he is being watched, then realize, understand that he is a mediocre person. So put him into roles where he is not very responsible, but to some extent responsible. If he is a pakka kamchor, if he is not, he is a hypocrite in terms of work, then you give him a menial job because he will work only under supervision. So such upadas Chanakya talks about. And he also talks about Kamopada. Try to test the Brahmacharya of the man. Does he fall for honey trap? Like we see how men and women fall for honey traps. So a girl, beautiful girl or a handsome young man, just you fall flat for them and you just reveal the secrets of your whole Rajya, etc. If somebody has that weakness, if he has a weakness for the other gender, then better be careful about how and where you recruit him. And then they have the Arthopada. If a person has the temptation to take bribes or give bribes, be careful about recruiting them. So there are many details about this where Chanakya tells about use Upadha before you appoint somebody. Look, it's not just somebody's degree or training. He's a degree holder from Harvard University, is a degree holder from this school of business, that school of politics, etc. We are just seeing the credentials, we are just seeing their, in fact we mostly see their capacity to speak English, a bunch of English words and a little bit of Western lifestyle and Western dresses have become the measure of worth for us today, unfortunately. But actually the measure of one's worth should be one's ethical standards foremost. If one falls in ethics, what is the use of one being a very big learned person or a scholar? It's all waste because he or she is very dangerous to the society. So being very ethically clean, morally clean, to have a very, very clean character is most important. So Dharmopada, Arthopada, Kamopada concepts of Chanakya are really very, very beautiful and they were also implemented in most of the Indian systems. And coming to one very interesting observation about Raja Dharma. We have this famous Kalidasa's Raghuvamsha Kavya. We all know Kalidasa to be just a poet, a great poet, a wonderful poet, a darshanika kavi, yes, no doubt. But we also must realize that he was a great, he was very, very familiar with Raja Dharma because you see his kavyas. His understanding of Raja Dharma is perfect there. So it is very beautifully substantiated in the Raghuvamsha, which is a record of the life of some great kings of the Raghu clan. He starts from Dilipa and he comes down to Rama, then Kusha and Then he fast forwards and ends with Agnimitra. So in the Raghuvamsha, he tells about how the Raghuvamsha kings were extremely ideal kings who were so well trained, and even the DNA was so good. They belonged to a family which was so committed to Raja Dharma. And some of the words, adjectives he uses to denote these Raghuvamsha kings is very interesting. It gives us a glimpse into how a Raja should be. What is an Adarsha, an ideal king like? He says, Ajanma Shuddhana. So they have a flawless character, Ajanma, from childhood onwards. It's not like, oh, in the when his younger days, you know, he was like that, like this. So nobody can pass a comment on them. So they lived a very, very pure life from their very younger days. Flawless record they have. And then, Afalodaya Karmana. They were Afalodaya Karma. They used to perform, they used to act, they used to implement their actions and keep trying and trying till they got the fall. Like they would never give up. That means that they were real performers. So to be a performer is very important. We have many excuses to give up midway. So Prarabdham Uttama Janaha Na Parityajanti, says Raja Bhartrihari in his Subhashita. So the Adhamas, the very substandard people, are those people who are Vigna Bhayena, without fear of Vignas, fear of obstacles, fear of, they lack confidence. So they hardly work at all. Then we have the Madhyamas. We have the Madhyamas who, once they have somebody ridicules them, or they have some small obstacles or some small failures or something doesn't work out for them in their way, so immediately they give up. And then you have the Uttamas, Prarabdham Uttama Janaha Na Parityajanti. Even though they face a lot of failures or disappointments, they consider that as a part of the way. Like when we travel from a place to place, the road is never straight. It's like this, and there are ups and downs, and there are potholes, and it will be broken somewhere. You may have to take an extra bypass road, or you may lose your way, or there may be a traffic jam, or there may be an accident in between. So there are so many obstacles that come our way before we reach our goal. But still, just keep going, going, going. So that is the attitude one a performer will have. So here he says, Afalodaya Karmana. Till they got the outcome of their karma, they would keep trying and trying. They would work hard to do that. And Anakarata Vartmana. So their ratha, their chariots used to go from heaven to hell. That means that they were very, very widely traveled. A leader, a king, should not just sit in his cozy chamber, AC chamber, and dictate things. He should travel, he should go a lot. These days we have some stupid comments about our great leaders who travel to foreign countries, saying that they are doing foreign tours. It's not about just foreign tours. A leader has to travel. He has to see people, he has to meet people, he has to connect to people, he has to see the poorest of poor, the richest of the rich. He has to meet external friends outside the country, inside the country. He has to also try to negotiate with possible enemies also. So this is a part of Raja Dharma, and we better keep quiet when we talk about our leaders going out for negotiating for the good of our countries. Of course, we may have some corrupt politicians who take the chartered flights and carry their children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren, everybody, and have tours at the cost of our taxpayers' money. I'm not talking about them. But it's a part of Raja Dharma to be widely travelled, because that gives them a lot of experiential understanding of the kingdom within and outside. Yatha vidhi hutagninam. So they used to practice all the Vaidika rituals perfectly, to have a lot of faith in the Vaidika Dharma, the Dharma they practice, and to actually practice that, implement that. Oh, I'm a Raja now, I don't believe in all this. This should never happen. Once you are a Raja, you represent a heritage, you represent a whole system. So you are carrying the beautiful heritage with you. You have to pass it on to the future generations. So you have to, with great Shraddha, do that. You have to do and encourage people to do. So the Raghuvamsha people practiced all the beautiful dharmika vidhis very with great devotion and faith. Yatha kamachitarthinam. So arthi means people who came to ask them, plead them for help or for money or for support, etc. So they used to very judiciously give them help. It's not that, oh, I'm very generous. Like, if somebody needs just 100 rupees, I'll give you 10,000 rupees because that makes me feel I'm very generous. No, that is not what a king should do. It's not that you just lavishly use your money, you have to very judiciously use it. The word is so beautiful. It shows that Kalidasa also had a very good understanding of Rajadharma. Then he says, Yathaparadha Dandana. They used to give danda according to the aparadha. In the Smritis, we have one saying, the Yajnavalkya Smriti also says that for the same danda, for the same punishment, for the same crime, sometimes you have to give different punishments to different people. The Smriti says that a teacher or a Vedic Pandita or a king or a ruler or a trainer, somebody who is in a position who knows all the Shastras well, who knows the system well, commits a sin, he should be given very, very severe punishment. If an ordinary commoner commits the same crime, he should be given a smaller punishment. But a very, very innocent person, a tribal person or a child or a teenager, somebody who is very innocent, doesn't know anything, is just not trained in this, commits the same crime, he or she should be immediately forgiven, but with the condition that he or she will not repeat the crime. So these are the subtleties which perhaps we don't follow these days. Today we talk too much about equality, but where is equanimity? That is a big question. Because if you say you have 10 people standing there, you want them all to be equal, go to cut the heads or the legs to make them equal is stupidity. That will not work. We have to use the idea of it is a differentiated approach is necessary so that we give justice to everybody. If one person is short, he may need a taller chair. If one person is very tall, he may need a shorter chair. So it's according to their necessities. So here, yathaparadha dandana. The danda, the punishment was given according to the crime and according to the person doing the crime. So sometimes samadana beda danda, they say. First thing is, first tell them in good words, advise them sternly not to repeat that. If they repeat, then it is dana. Tell them very strictly with a little bit of threat. And then it is bheda. Bheda is when you try to use some threat so that they are afraid to do that again, or you give them a smaller punishment. And then finally it is dandopaya. Danda is where you really give a very very big punishment and see that even others will never commit this mistake. So sama, dana, bheda, danda are four levels of punishing. And then he says they used to collect a lot of wealth, they used to earn a lot of wealth. Tyagaya samhritarthana, they used to collect wealth to give it away in charity. It was not for their, like we see in the European models, the pre-Renaissance models, where the queens or the kings were. The queens particularly used to be just the beauty queens, lying on a couch, nail polish queens, just enjoying all the pleasures, or the kings just dictating what they wanted to do, whatever came to their mind. No, it is not like that. The dinacharya of a king is very, very tough. If you just read the dinachari, the routine of a king, according to Chanakya's Arthashastra, or the Smritis, or as we see in Ramayana, Mahabharata, they had to wake up in the Brahmi Muhurta. And the first thing they had to do is all their Atma Dhyana and their rituals, etc. And then they had to do Mantrana. The very, very confidential meetings with their Gudacharis, spies, etc. Something very important in national interest, they had to do it in the wee hours of the morning. And they used to have a very, very tight schedule, and most of the time was only for the Prajas. So Raja used to have very little time for himself. That was how it was. So they were very, very committed to the society. They were not the bhogi type of people. Of course they had bhoga. Of course they had all the pleasures of being a king. They had a lot of fame. They had palatial palaces and coaches, and they enjoyed the physical comforts, no doubt, but only by giving a lot of their mind and energy and time to the society. And Kalidasa talks about how the Raghuvamsha kings evolved by age. Shaishave Abhyasta Vidyanam. In a very young age, at a very young age, they used to study all the Vidyas that a king or a prince had to study. Yavane Vishayachiram. At youth, they enjoyed all the pleasures. but asakta sukam anvabhut. They used to enjoy all the pleasures, but asakta, they used to be detached also. The art of connecting and disconnecting, the art of plugging in and plugging out is very important. That is what we don't teach our children today. We just pamper them with too much of goodies. So they don't know where to stop. And without that thing, they just can't live. So they become obsessed by comforts. So that should not be. We should be comfortable. So we should learn to plug in to a pleasure or a comfort and also plug out. We should learn to be without also. There's a very interesting tale about a great Hindi saint. It seems he used to go and visit, frequently visit his friend's house. A friend was a shopkeeper, and this, I don't remember the name of the saint, he goes to his friend's shop every day, sits for some time and sees all the objects there and asks his friend, how much, what is the cost of this, what is the cost of that, what is the cost of that? And his friend would tell him the cost of everything. And this person would not buy anything and come back. He would repeat that day again, day and every day. So one day his friend asked him, you ask the cost of every object here but buy nothing. Why do you ask the cost every day? Then the saint says, I tell myself how many things I can live without. So I am happy without even so many things. So that is what I am telling myself. That is a mindset which we have to develop. The problem of plenty is a big mental disease which our youngsters are facing today. We get too many things too easily, so we have no value for anything. We use and throw. That attitude is very wrong. That is why we use so much plastics, we waste so much of water, we waste so much of food, we waste so much of resources, and we also use and throw people also, and which will really cost us very badly in our future days. So all this is because we don't teach them how to control their senses, how they have to be asakta sukam anubhavu, be detached. Or with all the enjoyment, also learn to disconnect, also learn to put a full stop or a comma somewhere and know where to stop, how to stop. And vardhakye munivrittinam, once we begin to age, you have to gracefully age and detach and give the baton to the next generation. We see our very, very cheap politicians who are ripe old but don't want to hand over anything to their younger generations. Or even if they hand over, it's to their sons, their grandsons, their daughter-in-laws. And you know, it's, you see the cheap me, mine, my family, my community, my caste, etc. But to very gracefully do everything for the society and very gracefully detach is a way. We hear of the great Raja Lalitaditya of Kashmir. Raja Lalitaditya of Kashmir was one of the most valorous kings, a very, very accomplished king, who built wonderful temples. He was a great builder, he was a great valiant person, a great ruler, and many things. As long as he was there to guard the northwest frontiers of India, not a single Arab could enter our country. So, such a great ruler he was. There's a legend about Lalitaditya that the day he decided that I'm going to retire, he just gave away everything to his next successors, his ministers, and he just walked away like a sannyasi with just a lion cloth. He walked into the Himalayas, never to even turn back and say bye. So that was a kind of nirlipti, virakti he had. So perform with all interest like Rama did. Rama is one of the best examples we have. The day he was announced as he's going to be the next Yuvaraja, he got ready, he was happy. People were cheering him, he was getting ready for the coronation the next day. But overnight everything turned against him, and Kaikeyi played a big mischief, and he was no more going to be coronated. He had to go to the forest, but no problem. He lived in the forest very happily. He did not sit there brooding about, oh, this should not have happened to me. Why did this happen to me? He would have got BP and diabetes. But he just forgot and forgave, and he enjoyed his 14 years of stay in the forest. He enjoyed the forest. He enjoyed the company of the rishis. He learned many things. He protected many people. So that is a way of an optimist. And when the 14 years were over, he came back and happily became a king. He didn't do an article saying, oh, come on, I don't want anything. So no drama. He was, if you do something, yes, do it to the, do it with all your heart. If you live something, live it. We have the example of one of the very famous politicians of our country. I will not name him, but who denied being taking up any office in the independent India, but always kind of did backseat driving, saying you don't do this, don't do that. So if you really are interested, come to the front and do, or just go away and forget. So this kind of a hypocrisy should not be in a king. So the Raghuvamsha Rajas were like that. Yogenante Tantyaja. They were so fulfilled in their lives that they were spiritually elevated because of their karma yoga. So Rajadharma done to perfection actually becomes a karma yoga. It is a form of spiritual penance. Because whatever we do, everything we do can be a tapasya. So tapasya or dharma or karma is not just what we do in a puja graha, not what we do in a mandir. That is only one form. Bhakti, archana, puja, kirtana, yatra, that is only one form. You can also be a great karma yogi, doing your duty to perfection and saying Krishna arpanam is the biggest tapasya you can ever do. The whole of Ramayana, if you can observe in Ramayana and Mahabharata, the lifestyle of the princess is mainly presented to us in the form of the beautiful duties they did. We don't know how many pujas or ratas or homas and yagas Rama did. Of course, we know he did some Ashwamedha yagas, etc. But the focus is more on his dharma, more on his dutifulness, more of on his duty towards his father, towards his prajas, towards his family, etc. In fact, the best example of Raja Dharma, commitment for Samashti Hita, for Praja Hita, you see in Rama is when he was suddenly sent to the forest overnight. You just imagine that situation. If anybody else was in that situation, overnight Kaikeyi calls him and says, "You have Bharata will be the king instead of you, and you have to retire to the forest for no mistake of his." Anybody else would have asked, "But why?" Or he would have fought, he would have cried, he would have wailed and said, "Oh, this is unfair, this is not right." He could have called his friends, his cousins, people of Ayodhya, and started a rebellion and saying, "This is wrong, I want justice, I want justice." He would have asked his father, he would have even thrown out his father and become the king. So he could have done anything, or he could have delayed, saying, "Okay, I'll wait till the morning comes and by then people will themselves come and support me." He didn't even buy time. He thought in a very different way. That is why he is Lord Rama. Because he didn't think like an ordinary man. He thought like Rama. He thought like the most selfless person. He thinks, if I now question my Raja, my king, my father, I know he does not have an answer. He is bound by his promise, his word to his wife. So he cannot go back on his word. But he has promised the people of Ayodhya that he will make me the Yuvaraja. So he is also bound by promise to the people. He is in a dilemma. He doesn't know which promise to hold on to. And Kaikeyi is, she is just stubborn. She cannot be convinced now. And now if I wail, if I cry, if I ask questions, my father, that old king, he will definitely be in a very, very tight position. He just cannot answer. He is already so weak. He is crying. He is devastated. So it is not fair on my part to further torment my very, very sad father, very helpless father. And he realized that he has to better keep quiet. And then he thought like a prince. Now, if I go to the forest, what will happen to the kingdom? Bharata will become the king. Okay, what type of a person is Bharata? He's a very good man. He's learned, he's well trained, and he's the next, the right heir to the throne also. And he is very noble, committed, selfless. So the prajas will have a good king after all. So there will be no problem to the prajas. Kaikeyi will be happy that her son has become the king. Okay, she'll be happy. Now Dasharatha also will not become answerable anymore. And who is finally offended here? Only me. The problem is the injustice is only to me individually. So I will forgive. He decided to forgive. So he held his Vyashti Dharma, his Vyashti, his personal interest lower than the Samashti Hita. If Rama was like today's politicians who held his personal desire to become the king as foremost, what would have happened? What would have happened? He would have worked otherwise. He would have bought time. He would have brought people together and a big fight. You see how a politician, some cheap politicians, they are in the jail for all the dirty things they did. They have hoarded money like anything. They just come out of jail for just on a bail. They come and they give money to their people and create dramas to garland them. Such cheap things, dramas they do. But here Rama, even before people wake up, he knows that the people will stand by him. and people want him. He knows the people's opinion very well, but he did not want this big drama to happen where there will be two parties, Rama party, Bharata party, and fighting against each other, and like people do today, pelting stones and burning vehicles and so on. He didn't want all this to happen because of him. So he just silently slipped away into the jungles. The greatness of Rama rises here. He was ready for Tyaga, any amount of Tyaga. So this is what makes Rama, Raja Rama. So that is why our Swami Vivekananda says, so Raja, if you say Raja, it's only Rama, and Queen, it is only Sita, because their life was only for the Prajas. In fact, later on also, they had to live apart simply to close the loose tongue, the mouth, the uncultured mouth of their Prajas. They knew they were wrong, the Prajas were wrong, but it's better we stop their loose talk by our Tyaga. So it's very difficult to be like a Rama and difficult to be like Krishna. But what we understand from their lives is that they were committed to Samashti Dharma. A Raja should always think of the good of the society and not oneself. So this is the core of the Bharatiya Raja Dharma, which we understand. And unfortunately today has been kind of forgotten. I don't say everybody, they are very committed leaders. We are very lucky to have some very good leaders today. But still, it has to seep into the system where every individual has to always hold the national interest above one's personal interest. So this is these are just glimpses into Raja Dharma I tried to present to you. There are many, many, many more. And a multi-dimensional, a very Bahumukhi personality, we say Bahumukhi Vyaktitva. A Raja should not be just a ruler, he should be valorous, he should be intelligent, he should be a Dharmatma, he should be a Tyagi, he should be ready for any amount of sacrifice, and first and foremost, he should think of himself as a Praja Sevak. So, this is just a summarized form of the concepts of Raja Dharma. There are many more also. I've just tried to focus on the ethical aspects. So I thank the Anubhakta Parishad for this wonderful opportunity to pick up some beautiful thought pearls from our Bharatiya literature and present it before you all. Thank you so much. Namaste. Bolo Bharat Mata Ki Jai.
I would like to thank Madam Srimati Shri Aarti Madam. Really, it was a wonderful experience hear about these, throwing light on these beautiful topic. It is a glimpse into Bharatiya Raja Dharma, where I could see that I would like to take a pick out for some of the aspects, that is Raja Dharma. It is a, especially you made a, throw a light on, especially on the Mysore Vadaiyar, and from the Mughal period, that is Middle Age, and then you came to Smriti era, and then you explained about the Raja Dharma, how it is noble, and how the qualities of the Raja, it is being explained, and not only the Raja, even you try to explain about the queens also, that is Patta Maheshi, which you explained with beautifully, that even the queens were selected, and related the Raja is a Praja Sevak. It was a very beautifully stress on this, and Raja is a real father of the people, and even you explained related the difference between the Ishti and Samashti, and most of the Sanskrit words were being explained here with so that the audience can understand in a better way, and especially on the Dinachari of Raja according to the Chalukya, and his the how the usage of the resource can be done by the nationalities and the people of country, and I would like to conclude that with the word same from the Aarti Madam, that is Swami Vivekananda. He told that the best Raja is Rama and the best the queen is Sita. It is a very beautifully explained by you, that is how the code of Raja Dharma is very important in present situation, so that the people should know that what are the perfect control over his senses, which was really explained in a better way, and I would like to thank Madam, and even now today the vote of thanks will be done by Tejas De, Adivakta Parishad, Bangalore.
Namaskar everybody. It was very pleasant to have this अभियुक्त परिषद कर्नाटक साउथ जोन बैंगलोर यूनिट हैज ऑर्गेनाइज्ड दिस वेबिनार ऑन द टॉपिक ऑफ ग्लिम्स इनटू भारतीय धर्म एंड व्हेन वी अप्रोच्ड मैडम श्रीमती आरती she was wholeheartedly she has consented in spite of her busy schedule we from adivakta wholeheartedly thank madam for enlightening and mesmerizing her views about the concept of dharma as we all know the concept of dharma plays very important role even in our judicial system even in our life being the legal fraternity we should never forget one terminology that dharma rakshite rakshitah so if we protect dharma and dharma protects us so the entire gist of today discussion which madam has very mesmerizingly emphasized on this and avidakta parishad bangalore unit also thanks shri prakash rao president and shri rohit gowda general secretary for organizing this webinar also thank today the coordinator shrimati madhvi r for her presentation and kumari kavya for her prayer we also thank the web host news13.com and for live broadcast and finally thank all the viewers for joining the live program thank you all we will be coming up many such talks many such seminars thank you all.
ನಮ್ಮ ಲೇಟೆಸ್ಟ್ ವಿಡಿಯೋಗಳಿಗಾಗಿ ರೈಟ್ ಆಂಗಲ್ ಮೀಡಿಯಾ ರಾಮ್ಗೆ ಸಬ್ಸ್ಕ್ರೈಬ್ ಮಾಡಿ ಬೆಲ್ ಐಕಾನ್ ಒತ್ತಿ.